what I'm going to do today is to tell you about an area of environmental science, the study of toxic trace metals. And in particular, so it's a relatively large field. And I'm going to talk about two different metals. Lead, which I'm sure you've all heard a lot about recently due to the Flint water crisis. And then mercury, which is another very insidious toxic metal. Both are potent neurotoxins, and exposure to these metals can cause severe neurological problems as well as many other health problems. There are thousands of people across the world that study these two metals in the environment, and we have whole conferences on one metal or the other, and thousands of people come. What I'm going to do is focus on my area of expertise, and that is what I have done over the years is to develop new methods for fingerprinting sources of these metals to the environment and for following these metals around, these invisible metals around through the environment to try and figure out how people become exposed to them so that we can limit exposure. As you'll also notice, there's not a lot of physics in my title, but what you find over the years, if you do any science, there's always physics in your science. Physics is one of the fundamental fields. And I'm going to talk, the physics you're going to hear about relates to measurements that we make in my laboratory, very precise measurements of the mass of the atoms of mercury and lead, and that makes the basis for the isotopic fingerprinting. So, so just starting out, what are some of the main sources of lead exposure? So I'm going to start with lead, and then the second half of the talk will be about mercury. And what you'll see is that from the perspective of isotopic fingerprinting, they actually are very, very different. Their isotopic makeup varies for completely different reasons. And as a result, lead isotopes have been used to study the sources of lead in the environment for many, many years. It was pioneered over 50 years ago, actually by one of my mentors at Caltech, a professor named Claire Patterson. And the changes in isotopic composition are large, and they're relatively easy to measure with the tools of atomic physics and chemistry. Mercury isotopes evaded the use of isotopes for many, many years because the differences in isotopes are so much smaller that they require a different set of methods, and they had to wait about 50 years for the technology to advance to the point. I use mass spectrometers in my research, and so the technology of mass spectrometry had to advance to the point where we could start using mercury isotopes. So I'm going to talk about one of the oldest applications of isotopes to toxic metals, and then I'll talk about the most recent application. So the first thing, question for the audience. I don't know if you guys like audience involvement or not, but what are some of the main sources of lead exposure to children? Paint, okay, so we got paint. Okay, pipes, water. Okay, dirt, soil, sandboxes. Solder that you use to solder joints on pipes. And also they used to use to solder together cans of tuna fish, as it turns out. That's a big one that a lot of people forget, and I'm going to talk a lot about that. We used to put nearly a gram of lead in every liter of gas that was sold. And that lead was vaporized into the atmosphere and just inundated urban areas. So that's great. So let's look at my list and see how, I think we got them all actually. Ah, we missed one. Okay, so we've got pipes and solder, which we've already talked about. Oops, here goes my foray into the changer and the laser pointer built into one. So the pipes and solder, so lead pipes were used widely and are still in place in many older cities throughout the world, and then solder that holds the pipe joints together, even with copper pipes. Both interior and exterior paints before the 1980s were largely made up of lead. Most paints, in fact, were lead, and they were something like 10 or 20% lead, so it was a major component. Leaded gasoline, as I mentioned, until it was finally phased out in 1996, was added to gasoline and was released to the atmosphere through the combustion and settled in soils and in people's yards. And then something that's still an issue is paint on ceramics and toys. And this is something that For instance, the Ecology Center in Ann Arbor has warned people about that there are many imported toys that still use lead paint, and so the last thing you want is a little child chewing on a lead-painted toy. And then there are many ceramics and glazes that still have very high levels of lead, and this ceramic spoon, actually, that little red spot, that's a lead test indicator. If it turns red, it has lead, and it was just swabbed on that. So there's still a lot of things. When I was a kid, they actually used lead in the paint on bread bags, like Wonder Bread bags. And so if your parents turned them inside out and put your lunch in them and sent you off to school, and that was another major contributor. Okay, so we got lots of sources. So why are we so concerned about lead? Well, lead is as I said, a neurotoxin. It damages the brain and central nervous system. Slows the growth and development, particularly in children, leads to learning behaviors and hearing and speech impairments. So as a result, this can cause lower IQ, decreased ability to pay attention, and underperformance in schools. So this is something we're really concerned about. Now, I want you to imagine for a minute, most of you are not young parents. I have a hard time remembering what it was like to be a young parent. But you're a young parent, and you have a child who is, just started kindergarten, say, and you notice, and your teacher notices that your child is not developing at the same rate as many of the other kids in the class, and you become concerned. Discuss this with the teacher. Take your child to the pediatrician, and the pediatrician examines your child. Doesn't see any major, obvious problems, but. Decides to order a battery of tests, and one of those tests is for lead in blood, and the test comes back positive, and it's like, oh my God, my child has high elevated lead in their blood. So the first thing you want to do is figure out where that lead is coming from, and shut off that pathway that the child is by which the child is being exposed to the lead. So wouldn't it be nice if you could, paint the lead in all these different sources of lead exposure to your child, different colors, and then look at the color of lead in your child's blood and somehow match them up and figure out where your child is getting the lead. And the problem is that there's so many different sources of lead that it's not always obvious for any particular house or any particular child. And it's not just your house, but it may be your parents' house where the kids spend a lot of time, or a babysitter, or an in-home daycare. So I made this little goofy cartoon just to show different colors are just basically different sources of lead that a kid might be exposed to in a home or in a daycare. And this is these are all things that you all guessed as possible sources. So we have, and I'm going to stop using the laser pointer because I'm told it doesn't show up in the next room. But on the left side, we have exterior paint, soils, paint on windowsills, paint on the side of the house, dust that comes from the deterioration of old paint and from off of roofing materials. And then on the other side, we have interior windowsills, walls, paint. We have dust on the floor and the carpets, water in a household, toys, many other things. So what we'd like to do is be able to fingerprint these things so that we can be a detective and we can figure out where they're coming from. So here's a little bit of physics. So we have, up at the top, I show the nucleus of a lead atom, and it's made up of neutrons and protons. And then this little table here that I show shows that the element lead, and the chemical symbol for lead is Pb, and so I'm going to interchangeably use lead, LEAD, and PB, so get used to that. Lead has 82 protons, and so the number of protons defines what an element is. So every atom that has 82 protons is lead, but there are four different types of lead. There's lead with 122 neutrons, 124, 125, and 126 neutrons. So if we add the neutrons and the protons together, we get what's called the atomic mass, or the isotope mass. And so we can see over on the right, we have lead-204, lead-206, lead-207, and lead-208. And it's this makeup, this mixture of these different isotopes that varies in the environment, that we can use as a tracking tool. So the lower diagram shows the percent abundance of each of these isotopes of lead, 204, 206, 207, and 208. And it shows their relative abundance. And the variations I'm talking about are deviations from this normal abundance. Now, why in the world would lead isotopes vary in their abundance in different materials that we might find around the house? Well, lead, we know that lead that comes out of different ore deposits around the world has very different lead isotopic compositions. So if we go to a lead ore deposit in Colorado and we compare that lead to another mine in Idaho and compare that to one in Missouri, they're each going to have a different and characteristic lead isotopic composition. And the reason for this is that there are three elements that occur naturally in rocks and minerals, the three isotopes, uranium-238, uranium-235, and thorium-232. And each of these are naturally radioactive. So over geological time scales, they naturally decay. And that radioactive decay causes them to transform from uranium or thorium into lead. But the U-238 turns into lead-206, the U-235 turns into lead-207, and the thorium-232 turns into lead-208. So depending on the peculiarities of the geological deposit, how much uranium there is, how much lead there is, how old it is, how the ore-forming process has formed, we end up with different isotopic compositions. And then we have 204, which has no radioactive parent at all. That's just straight up lead that's left over from supernova explosions that basically produced heavy elements and introduced that into our solar system and was incorporated into the sun and the planets. Okay, so here's an example from the literature. I'm going to try and keep the number of data plots to an absolute minimum. But there are a few that I can't resist, and this is one of them. So this is a study that was done, and there are many case studies like this that have been done, where people have used the ratio of the lead isotopes to do detective work at a child's home to try and figure out where the lead's coming from. Now, I wish I could say that this was a routine method that was used widely, and it's not. And the problem is that it takes very specialized expertise and very specialized instrumentation. To do this work requires mass spectrometers, like we have in my laboratory, which cost upwards of $1 million or $1.5 million and require very specialized use. So it's been used in dozens of studies, but not in thousands like it should be, in my opinion. So the first thing we do is we bring into someone's house, you know, someone who let's go back to imagining our child who has elevated lead in his blood. We might first bring in a home inspector who specializes in tracking down lead paint and lead pipes and helping people understand the hazards in their home. And you can measure the concentration of lead very easily in all kinds of materials. So the amount of lead, and that's what's shown. That's what's shown on the upper left-hand diagram. We have the concentration of lead versus the sample type, and we have the outside doormat of the house, the child's bedroom carpet, the exterior window frame paint, so all the blue ones are paint, soil in the yard of the child, kitchen paint, door paint, dresser paint, and then the bedroom window paint in this particular house. And so we have paint in blue on the diagram, we have dust in mustard-colored, soil in black, and then blood sampled two different times, one 3 months after the other, blood of the child in red. And what you see is that when you look at the ratio of lead 207 to 204 and lead 206 to 204, you get this spread of values for these different media because the paints were the lead that went into the paints came from different mines and from different companies, and so you see a spread there. And then apparently the dust and the soil from this child's home, in this particular case, I'm not saying this is the general case, this is just a particular case, in this particular situation, the paint in the house does not seem to be what's providing the lead to the child and to their blood. Instead, it seems to be the soil and the dust outside. So there, the soil out in the yard is getting tracked into the house, and the dust and the soil, little kids like to put their hands in their mouths a lot, is being ingested. And so this is a case where we would focus on exposure in the yard as opposed to exposure, you know, from the paint. There are other cases where paint would be important. Now, the concentrations you see up here, you see, well, how do you know it's not, why isn't it the materials that have the really high concentrations? Well, it turns out that even the lowest bars on that graph are highly, highly elevated and are plenty high to contaminate a child and lead to high levels. Okay, so that's an example from, this is from Santa Cruz, California. Many other examples like it, and this is a method that's been around for a while. It's gotten perfected, it's gotten better. I'm kind of on a mission to convince the Environmental Protection Agency that they should be using this method more often. The last thing they need right now is expensive suggestions. But a few months ago, they were very receptive to this idea. Okay. So we've talked about lead in paint, and on this graph in the upper left, we have the total. I covered up the units, but it's a unit. It's a mass. Basically, the mass of lead used on a particular year, and then the year going from 1910 to 1990. And what you see is that lead in paint was a major use of lead, starting at, you know, in the turn of the century and up until the 1960s, 1970s. When it was phased out, and by 1990, pretty much wasn't being used in lead anymore. And that's why we tell people that if their house is older than 1980, they should be aware and they should check for lead paint. But if it's younger than that, it's probably not a problem. But what happened as the scientific community became aware of the dangers of lead in paint, and it was phased out from paint, another use came along. And this is the use of lead in gasoline. And so you can see that the green plot shows the mass of lead that was put into gasoline. And it climbed like crazy as all this lead became available and this technology became available. And it was shown that putting lead in gasoline increased the octane level and was basically an anti-knock agent. And so it was widely marketed and became, you know, the most common type of gas. And so when I was a kid in the 60s and 70s, you can see it was right at the peak when there was, you know, just massive amounts of lead were being released to the atmosphere, and we were being exposed to them. Now, I want to take a step back and tell you just a couple of little stories. Who are these two men who are staring at you? You know, Thomas Midgley and Claire Patterson. So I can tell you that one is a villain, and the other is my all-time hero. So which one do you think is which? Can you tell? I can't. Well, I'll save you the suspense. So Thomas Midgley is the villain, and Claire Patterson is the hero. Claire Patterson, as I mentioned earlier, was a professor at Caltech, and he was not my PhD advisor, but I had the privilege to get to know him well and actually to do some work in his laboratory. Thomas Midgley was a chemical engineer who worked for a number of different companies, but was the inventor of this process by which tetraethyl lead was added to gasoline to increase its octane levels. And so he pushed very hard, and he actually started a company which was a joint venture between General Motors, DuPont, and what was then Standard Oil and is now ExxonMobil. And they got together, they started, it's called the Ethyl Company, and they basically marketed and sold and made a tremendous amount of money off of lead additives and gasoline. And Patterson was a geochemist, an environmental geochemist, who actually, I don't know, with this crowd, probably everybody's seen Neil deGrasse Tyson's Cosmos. Yeah, so there's a whole episode about Claire Patterson. And they have this cartoon figure, he and his advisor. It's kind of a memorable thing. But anyway, so Claire Patterson, he was a PhD student at the University of Chicago in the late 1950s. And he worked with a group of scientists who had been working on the Manhattan Project, on nuclear, wartime applications of nuclear reactions and also nuclear power. And that's where the mass spectrometry, the methods that we use to measure the mass of atoms, was really perfected. And so using that technology, Patterson and his advisor had this idea that if you had minerals that occur in rocks that had high amounts of uranium, and you could measure the isotopic composition of the lead in the mineral as well as the amount of uranium in the mineral, and you knew the decay constant, which they, at that time they knew very well, that you could calculate the age of a material. And at that point, we didn't know the age of the Earth, we didn't know the age of the solar system. And so Patterson set out to figure out what the age of our solar system was. It was kind of a noble thing for a graduate student to do. And he took these minerals that have high uranium, and he took meteorites that were enriched, and he tried to measure the lead isotopic composition. And every time he'd go in the laboratory and he'd try to measure the lead, there'd just be massive amounts of lead, not just in the sample that he had digested, but also in just the reagents he was using and the beakers he was using. And what he found was that there was just a huge amount of lead in the dust and in the atmosphere in his laboratory. And he tried this in several different laboratories, and everywhere he went, he just found that the amount of lead just around him and on his skin and on his clothes and in his lab, in the water from the faucet, it was so much higher than he had ever imagined it could be that it made it impossible to make these measurements. So instead, he went to work building the first clean room. And so he built a chemistry clean room where all the air in the clean room was finely filtered and treated. And you'd go in and you'd put on a jumpsuit and all the reagents were distilled. And he basically spent all these years just trying to get the levels of environmental lead low enough that he could measure lead in these meteorites and rocks. Eventually, he figured out how to do it. He determined the age of the Earth and the solar system to be 4.55 billion years. And to this day, no one has made a better estimate. It's still, that's what we've, you know, it's been verified using six other methods, and it's 4.55 billion years old. So then when he finished this project, he said, well, now it's time to go back and figure out where all this lead is coming from. And so he's devoted the rest of his career to studying environmental lead, and he is the person who brought to the attention of the world the fact that this lead that was on the green line that was going into gasoline was in fact poisoning the entire population. And so he started measuring lead in children and in people. He measured lead in the atmosphere. He measured lead in all kinds of different places. And he became aware that this was a huge problem. But meanwhile, Midgley and his company hired a team of scientists, memories of the tobacco industry as well as the climate change deniers, but basically to try and discredit Patterson's work. And so Patterson spent his whole career fighting against industry scientists who were claiming that the amount of lead that Patterson was seeing was actually just the normal background and had always been there and had nothing to do with what was being added to the gasoline, and that it wasn't a serious problem. And it turns out Patterson was right. So Midgley, Midgley is single-handedly responsible, at least for me personally, having a few lower IQ points, given when I was raised. And after he finished working on lead, and after lead was banned from gasoline, he went on to discover freon, which is of course the CFC that leads to the decline in ozone in the atmosphere. And so he was responsible for two of the biggest environmental catastrophes of my lifetime. So, okay, so Patterson studied this increase in gasoline, and let's see, what do I have in the next slide? Yes, and so one of the things Patterson did is he went out to freeways in LA near Caltech, and this has been done now many times. What I show below is just the idea. There's a lot of cheap land near freeways, and that tends to be where elementary schools and daycare centers are built. And in that upper diagram, this is not Patterson's work. This is a recent, very similar thing to what Patterson did from a roadway in Indianapolis. And what you see is that the concentration of lead in soils near freeways is higher than away from freeways. And this is the distance from the roadway in meters. And the closer you are to the roadway, the more of this tetraethyl lead has been deposited over that 20 or 30 years when lead was so popular in gasoline. And as you get further away from roadways, that decreases. And so this is, again, something that, in fact, Patterson, I believe, was responsible for having the daycare center at Caltech moved. And he yelled at one of my fellow graduate students. He was always, you know, really, you know, teaching us the right and wrong things to do. You know, one of the things you should never do is drink warm water from your faucet, because it sits in the pipes and in the water heater longer, where there's an opportunity to leach lead from solder. And I had a fellow graduate student who had a baby while we were graduate students, and she was making formula for the child in the department kitchen and was using warm water. And I remember, I'll never forget him walking in one day and just flipping out and yelling at her and everything else. Okay, he was passionate about this. Okay, so that's one thing. So another thing that Patterson, this is, I love this diagram because it's so non-statistical. And so, but you see the little freckles on this man? So what? So Midgley and his team went out and basically measured people all around the world, or all around the United States, and found that everybody had elevated lead. And he said, well, we've always had elevated lead. It's nothing to worry about. It's not going to cause any problem. Patterson said, no, that lead is coming from gasoline. And so he went, so one of the many studies he did, he went and he studied, he went with archaeologists and dug up bones from Peruvian indigenous peoples who had never been exposed to industry. And he looked at the lead levels in their bones and compared that to the lead levels in bones of people living in urban areas. And what he shows is that one dot, it's a unit of concentration, okay? So that's 40 micrograms of lead. That's what the natural level before industrialization in humans was. The middle one with all those freckles shows that there are many hundreds of times elevation in lead in the average person in the US when he did this in the 1970s, I think it was. And then the one on the right, which shows more freckles, is the concentration for overt clinical lead poisoning. And so what he was arguing was that the average person in the US is a lot closer to being overtly poisoned than they are to having natural levels. So I think that's pretty exciting. Okay. So one more example using lead isotopes. And this is something that Patterson tried to do, and he kind of inferred this in many different ways, but was never able to do the definitive experiment in the US, largely because it was blocked by political powers that wouldn't let these things be done. But in Italy, there's a scientist who was able to do this, and it's called the Turin experiment, lead and petrol. And so in northern Italy, there's a large city, Turin, which is in a location where it's nestled between a couple of mountain ranges, and it has generally the air masses stay put, has low winds. And it also had the highest density of cars to people of any city in Europe. And what they did there was they got permission to switch the lead isotopic composition of all the lead going into gasoline for a couple year period and then watch what happened to the population. And so what they did, if you look at this diagram, on the left axis is a lead isotope fingerprint, lead 206 over lead 207. And European lead that's put into European gasoline had the value of 1.18. That's the upper arrow on the left. And that was the value in gasoline. He then, the Facchetti, who is the author of this study, got lead from Australia, which had much different isotopic composition. It had a lead 206, 207, you can see down at the bottom here, of 1.04. And what he did was he took, you can see the years down here, from 1974 to 1986. He took, and he looked, so what this red plot is the isotopic composition of lead in that was put into gas. So it went from 1.18, they dropped it over a couple year period down to 1.05, and then raised it back up and were able to watch what happened. So the first thing we want to know is, let's look at the lead that's just floating around in the atmosphere on particles. You know, does it change when you change the isotopic composition of lead? And that's the green line. Okay, so clearly the lead that we're breathing, the lead that is being deposited onto the soil around a city is coming from the lead that's being put in gasoline, and it just mimicked it perfectly. The next thing he did was to take the average blood isotopic composition of lead of people, of adults in Turin, and looked at that, and he got the purple line. So it started out a little bit lower than petrol. It dropped some as the petrol value dropped, and then it increased as the petrol value went up. But it didn't show that magnitude of swing. And this basically demonstrated that 25% of this new lead that was added was found in people's blood. But there was still about 75% of the lead over that couple year time period that was not from the new petrol. It was from old petrol and other sources. And so that could be from other exposure, from lead pipes, from food, from wine, which that nice soft metal wrapping they used to put around the tops of wine bottles was lead. And then also, lead substitutes for calcium in bones. And so when you're exposed to lead, it gets stored in your bones. And as your bones are as the calcium is remobilized from your bones over time, it takes many years, the lead from your bones goes into your blood and eventually is exchanged with the new lead. So what they saw here was clear evidence that when you change, that the lead at any given year being burned in cars was showing up in your blood, but also it didn't go to equilibrium. There was a longer time period for it to be sort of flushed out of your system. So that was, I thought, a really interesting application of lead of lead isotopes. And so if we look now just just to wrap up on lead, so I can get started on mercury, the average blood lead in the US population is shown on the left-hand axis, and then the year is on the right-hand axis. And what you can see is that we were at a very high level in 1975. That was the year that lead paint was banned, and then a few years later, leaded gasoline, the beginning of the phase-out occurred, largely due to Patterson's work. And so the amount of lead in people's blood dropped precipitously. Lead plumbing was banned in 1986, and then there was an EPA rule for lead that required monitoring of lead and copper concentrations in municipal water supplies in 1991. Lead in food can solder and also in pipes was banned around in the early 90s, and then leaded gas, the end of the phase out occurred in 1996, and you can see how the amount of lead in our blood dropped as the EPA did studies, recognized what was going on, and implemented legislation to protect our health. Okay, and then this is the percentage of children from 1 to 5 years old in the US population that had elevated blood levels. And so you can see from 1976 to 1980, it was 80% of children had elevated levels, 88%. So that's when I was a child, yay. And that these actions really decreased it pretty dramatically down to something like a 90% decrease by the 2000s. So that's a happy note, right? So that's background on lead. What I want to do next is switch to mercury. And mercury, like lead, is found in high concentrations in many household products and in many, and people are exposed to it. Near industrial sites. But what's different about mercury from lead is that when it goes into the atmosphere, it doesn't just deposit within tens of meters of a freeway. It goes and it goes into the atmosphere as a gas, and it doesn't attach to particles immediately. And it can stay in the atmosphere for a couple of years, which is enough time for it to circulate around the entire globe, go to the polar regions, the Arctic and Antarctic. And so there's virtually no ecosystem, no matter how remote or how pristine on Earth, that doesn't have mercury being deposited into it from the atmosphere. And so it just has a very different chemical makeup. So just to give you I'm kind of enamored with mercury, so I want to tell you a little bit about some of the interesting properties. One is it's a liquid metal at room temperature with a very high density, and there's actually a bottle right here it's extremely dense, I can barely pick it up, of liquid mercury. It's a metal at room temperature. It forms a non-reactive gas in the atmosphere. And this is a picture over here showing a little pool of mercury, and you can see that the vapor's coming off it in ultraviolet light. If that didn't have a stopper in it, it would just be evaporating mercury. There are chemical changes that take place in nature the mercury goes from a metallic form to an oxide form to a methyl mercury form, which is an organic form. And in so doing, it's like a completely different element. It goes from, so it sort of has this Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. It's relatively less toxic in the metallic form and much, much, much more toxic in the organic form. And I'll talk more about that in a minute. One example of this is that my fillings are 50% mercury, any metal fillings that anybody has. Who has metal fillings? Okay, so there's a lot of metal fillings. Every time any of us who have metal fillings breathe in, some of that vapor goes into our lungs, and every time we breathe out, we are contributing mercury to the atmosphere. And when we go near, in my laboratory, I can't breathe on the instrumentation that measures mercury because it sends the needle off the chart. But we'll come back to that. So if I took this mercury and I fed it to a certain type of bacteria that turned it into organic mercury, and I put that in the mouths of all of you in the room, it would be enough just from my fillings to probably kill everybody in the room. I mean, it's that potent, okay? So we'll come back to that. So it can become highly toxic due to methylation and bioaccumulation. I won't leave you stranded. Okay, so some interesting facts about mercury. It's found in archaeological ruins dating back as far as the Bronze Age. And I started out the talk, I didn't mention what this red rock was, but that's the geological form that mercury normally occurs in. It's mercury sulfide or cinnabar. And it was used as a pigment from very early times. And I've actually done a lot of work now with archaeologists looking at both the use of the sulfide in archaeological ruins, but also the metal mercury is relatively easy to make and has been found in ruins dating as far back as 4000 BC. Also in the terracotta soldiers in China, in Xi'an, there were areas where the emperor they produced tons and tons of metallic mercury, and they used it as artificial rivers to sort of for the scenes that they made with the terracotta soldiers, because it shimmered and looked like water. That was 200 BC. Till very recently, it was used in topical antiseptics and skin creams. And when I was a young kid, it was still being used as an antiseptic. It was still in a lot of types of makeup it still is actually, but it was widely used as recently as 10 years ago. And sort of state by state, it was banned from different makeups and things. And then it was also, just for interest, it was important in alchemy. Gold was thought to be produced by a mixture of mercury with other metals. Because if you mix mercury with gold, they amalgamate, they form a common liquid. And if you then burn off the mercury because it's volatile with a torch, you get the gold back. So to early scientists, it looked like you were turning mercury into gold. Okay, so what are some of the main uses of mercury? Let's go back to thermometers. That's a biggie. Thermostats is another switches. What? Light bulbs, fluorescent light bulbs, yes, and
blood pressure machine.
Blood pressure machine, yeah. So barometers. In fact, they used to use it in airplanes. As a barometer to tell what altitude they were flying at.
Silent switches.
What kind of switch?
Silent.
Silent switches. Yes. In fact, trunk switches in almost all cars. You know how when you lift in older cars you lift the trunk and the light goes on. Before they had computers, and you always wondered how that worked, and that was basically a little bead of mercury in a glass tube with a couple of contacts, and the metallic mercury would roll down and make a contact between the two. Okay, so let's see how many we got. Okay, so we got, mercury amalgams in teeth are 50% mercury. There's a little switch in the middle. You can see if that ball of mercury rolled backward and it would make a contact. Batteries are large use of mercury. And then ethyl mercury is used in vaccines to keep stuff from growing as a preservative. It's called thimerosal, and it was widely used in the U.S. as well as the rest of the world. It's very uncommon now in the U.S., but still is used in many parts of the world. So those are some of the major uses. Some of the main inputs to the environment. Coal is by far the largest input to the environment. The coal it turns out burning coal just dwarfs the other sources of mercury to the atmosphere. And so the atmospheric levels of mercury have tripled since we started burning coal. Incinerators were a huge source until the EPA put some rigid restrictions on them and they now have to trap a lot of the mercury that comes out. So that's been reduced. Well, anytime you break a fluorescent light bulb in your house, you're getting a bead of mercury may be in your carpet, for all you know. On the right side is artisanal gold mining, which is actually the second biggest source of mercury to the atmosphere. And this is sort of mom and pop, small scale gold mining all over the world, where they basically take a pool of liquid mercury and they run the sediments from streams and from rocks through that mercury, and the mercury dissolves the fine gold and makes an amalgam or a solid solution between the two metals. And then when they're done with that, they take it, put it in a metal tray, and they torch it with a propane torch. The mercury evaporates, and they're left with gold. But this exposes a very large population to vapor mercury. Okay, so it's ubiquitous in the environment. We find it in lakes, rivers, and oceans around the world. Like lead, it's a metal, so it doesn't decompose in the environment. The organic pollutants decompose eventually, but metals don't. They're there forever. And it's known to produce neurological disorders in levels that are present in the population of the U.S. So 5 to 10% of women of childbearing age exceed the recommended levels of mercury. And so it's a major health concern. And mercury can undergo what we call molecular mimicry, where it bonds with certain amino acids, can, for instance, sneak through the blood-brain barrier by fooling your body into thinking that it's something else. And it has a very complex chemistry that controls its mobility and toxicity. Okay, so how do we know that the amount of mercury in the atmosphere has gone up, and how do we know that it's globally distributed? Well, this is a diagram. When we want to know these kinds of things, that are how much of a particular metal is deposited from the atmosphere, we go to a lake, certain types of lake, and we got in a boat and we drop a coring device and we bring back a core of sediment from the bottom of the lake. And so what that's done is every year there's sediment and organic matter deposited in the bottom of the lake, and along with it is the mercury, and actually lead, we can do the same thing, that was deposited to the lake that year. And so we can profile the cores of sediment and we can figure out the rates of deposition of metals. And so what we have on the y-axis here is the mercury accumulation rate, and on the x-axis, the year from 1500 to 2000. So the green arrow is when we started burning coal, and the red and blue dots are lake sediments that have been dated from New Zealand and from Arctic Alaska, just to show that it has global extent, both the northern and southern hemisphere. And the black line is actually the amount of atmospheric carbon dioxide. And so this, when we started burning coal, we also started putting excess CO2 into the atmosphere, and they mimic each other very closely because they're being produced by the same thing, by burning fossil fuels. So at the risk of confusing you, I tried to simplify this as much as I possibly could. If any of my colleagues ever see this diagram, they're going to make fun of me because it's so oversimplified. The chemistry of mercury is very complicated. But the points I want to make are on the bottom here, these four points. And this is just showing the arrows, just showing the cycle of how mercury is transformed in the environment. About 2/3 of the mercury in the atmosphere, we now know, it comes from human sources. And basically burning of coal and use of mercury in mining are the two biggest sources. The inorganic mercury is what's transported globally, stays in the atmosphere for several years. When mercury gets into low oxygen environments like wetlands and sediments in the bottoms of lakes, there are bacteria that can turn it into an organic form called methylmercury. And it's methylmercury that is the more toxic form and also has this property where it's bioaccumulated. When an organism eats something that has methylmercury on it, it stays in their body and it builds up through time. And so as we go up the food chain, the amount of methylmercury in organisms increases. And then finally, sunlight turns organic mercury, the nasty kind, back into inorganic mercury, which is the not so nasty kind. So it's really important to know where and when mercury is getting exposed to the sun, because that can help remediate a particular lake or wetland. And so I'm showing the, you know, the emission, the blue arrows of the inorganic mercury, and it's coming down in rain. It's getting methylated, turning red over in the wetlands and in the bottom of the lake, and then it's being taken up into the food web of a lake or the ocean. So this is a diagram that shows this bioaccumulation or biomagnification process. So what you can see is on the left axis is the methylmercury concentration in an organism, or in water actually, but in a material. And you can see that that's a log scale. Each line is a factor of 10 higher in concentration. So we're looking, you know, we're going 8 orders of magnitude in concentration. And this is why methylmercury can be so nasty, is that it can be deposited into water at very low levels, but then bioconcentrated into an organism and biomagnified as each organism eats the next organism. So we have water, which the mercury is basically sticking to algae and other microorganisms. Then we have invertebrates that are eating the algae, small fish that eat the invertebrates, medium-sized fish that eat the small fish, and then large fish that eat the medium-sized fish. And each time, we get an order of magnitude, or a factor of 10, increase in the amount of methylmercury. So you don't have to have high levels in water to have high levels in fish. We know that tuna living out in the North Pacific Ocean, far away from any local emission sources, have very high levels of mercury. And it's not because there are pollution sources out there, it's because they feed at the top of a very long food web. And so what's important is the details of the food chain, even more so than the amount of mercury that's being deposited in a particular place. Okay, so this is my public service. So everybody wake up. The question is, which ocean fish should we avoid? Now, probably the most important thing I'll say this entire talk is you shouldn't stop eating fish. Fish is really good for you. It has omega-3 fatty acids. It's nutritionally a great source of protein. It's great for pregnant women to eat fish. But you have to pay attention to what type of fish you're eating. That is the key. This shows, again, on a log scale, the concentrations. So this is the concentration of methylmercury in various fish, and each of these is a factor of 10. And then these are the different types of fish that we commonly eat. And what you can see here is that if you go up here to salmon, fresh and frozen salmon, you have a relatively low concentration. And if you compare salmon to swordfish, swordfish has 3 orders of magnitude, or 1,000 times, nearly 1,000 times more mercury than salmon. So if we take tuna kind of as our standard, canned albacore tuna, we can eat 100 times more salmon for every meal of tuna that we have, and we can eat 10 times more cod for every tuna meal that we have. But we have to be careful when we're eating these fish. So the really high ones that you should just avoid in principle, swordfish, so my mother's sitting up in the audience, when I was a child, I didn't particularly like fish, and the only fish I would eat was swordfish, and so we ate a lot of swordfish. You shouldn't feed your kids swordfish, okay? So tilefish, shark, swordfish, orange roughy are the really, really bad ones, okay? Tuna fish, albacore, and white tuna, and fresh and frozen tuna steaks are pretty bad. Canned light tuna is moderate. And then the ones that are no problem at all are salmon, ocean perch, haddock, herring, et cetera, et cetera. And you can, this is the important take-home message. So to summarize this, I made this little diagram. And you can, there are many, the EPA has a website, the Food and Drug Administration. There's a particularly good one in the Natural Resources Defense Council website. So I encourage you to take a look at it. But basically, if you're a young woman or a child, you're particularly sensitive to mercury poisoning, because developing brains of children are very sensitive to it. And young women, not only, so when I say young women of childbearing age, not necessarily women who are going to be pregnant imminently, but basically, we all accumulate mercury through time, and so you don't want to be eating mercury over the many-year window of time when you may have children. So, so basically, young women and children should not eat these fish. Whoop, I went the wrong direction. Should not eat these fish: swordfish, shark, canned albacore, fresh tuna, orange roughy. Older women and men, once a month is should be the limit. Sea bass, grouper, candlelight tuna, and halibut, once a month for young women and children. Once a week is acceptable for older women and men. And then for cod, flounder, salmon, whitefish, ocean perch, haddock, once a week should be the maximum for young women and children, and unlimited for older women and men. So that's my public service announcement. Okay, so now on to something a little bit more along the same lines. So we imagined earlier that we had a small child and we were trying to figure out where they got their lead from. So now I want you to imagine that you're the parent, or you're the coach of a Michigan football player, and you're trying to get him to bulk up on his muscles and eat lots of protein and lift lots of weights. This is from the front page of the sports section in the New York Times a couple years ago. When, remember Taylor Lewan? So he was a very prominent football player on the Michigan team, and he turned down the NFL draft to stay for his final year because he liked playing at Michigan so much. And so the headline, when I was just happened to read this headline, and it just kind of blew my mind. Basically, let me just read it to you. So this is about Taylor Lewan, who's now on the Tennessee Titans. He consulted the team's nutritionist to revamp his diet. Now, every morning, he eats 6 hard-boiled eggs and 2 cans of tuna and downs a shot of olive oil. After he lifts weights, he drinks a protein shake and has 3 more eggs, 2 cans of tuna, and another shot of olive oil. For his afternoon snack, he eats 3 more eggs, 2 more cans of tuna, and that keeps him going until his dinner. And then he says, "The diet has consumed my life," shaking his head. So the question is, first of all, that's way too much tuna. And I did call the coaches, and I did talk with the trainers, and hopefully they've cut that back. But what if Taylor Lewan had metal amalgam fillings and was eating moderate amounts of tuna, and we wanted some way of telling, you know, where the mercury in his blood was coming from? We wanted to learn more about, you know, and this is kind of an extreme example, but I wanted to give you another example of the use of isotopes. So there are, similar to what we did with lead, there are ways that we can use mercury isotopes to fingerprint different sources to the environment. And this is the natural abundance of mercury isotopes. There's 7 isotopes. They range in mass from 196 to 204. So mercury is element 80. It has 80 protons, but it has a variable number of neutrons from 116 up to 124. And therefore, it has these 7 stable isotopes from 196 to 204. And we can, now there is no radioactive decay that produces particular isotopes of mercury, but it turns out, and we never would have guessed this until we just discovered this about 8 or 10 years ago, Patterson would have just been so happy. You know, the something that we did not predict, but basically, When mercury undergoes chemical reactions from products to reactants, there's a fractionation or a shift in the isotopic composition. Certain isotopes react more quickly than other isotopes in certain types of reactions. And this difference in reaction rate comes in 2 different forms. The top one, which is called mass-dependent fractionation, which is in blue for the rest of my slides. It means that this shift in the isotopic composition, if we took, on these diagrams, I've taken that bumpy pattern of mercury isotope abundances and I normalized it so that they all started out being 1. So it's just a normalized abundance. And then we undergo a reaction, and the products of the reactant are going to have different isotopic abundances, and they're going to vary linearly with the mass. So that's one type. And we see this kind of variation in geological sources of mercury. So inorganic mercury tends to shift in this way. But we also found that when mercury is subjected to sunlight, and there are reactions that are driven by sunlight, they're called photochemical reactions, mercury undergoes something called the magnetic isotope effect, which had never been seen in heavy elements until we started measuring this in my lab in environmental samples. And we've since done experiments to demonstrate what's going on. And basically, the odd mass number isotopes of mercury, mass 199 and 201, which have nuclear spin or nuclear magnetic moments, whereas the even isotopes don't, because of that, there's a selectivity for the odd isotopes. The odd isotopes undergo chemical reactions at a different rate than the even isotopes. And as a result, methylmercury, the kind of mercury that we find in fish that's gone through this complex path to get to the fish, always has this signal, this methylmercury signal, this photochemical signal. And we can use these two different types of signals, the mass-independent fractionation, or the red kind, versus the blue kind. And since I'm running out of time, I'm gonna skip a bunch of slides just to don't get nervous. So if we've got a football player and we want to know how much methylmercury is affecting him versus inorganic mercury in the form of amalgams or occupational exposure or exposure to broken thermometers or broken fluorescent light bulbs, it turns out that we have a really, really nice measure of methylmercury in this mass-independent isotope fractionation. This pattern of the isotopes is definitive for methylmercury versus another type that's definitive for inorganic mercury. So what we did is we got together with epidemiologists and doctors and dentists and did a number of studies where we explored how different forms of mercury are processed in the human body and what it means when you measure mercury in someone's hair versus mercury in someone's urine, how much what that tells you about their relative exposure to methylmercury versus inorganic mercury. So I'm going to skip the details of those studies, but it's turned out to be a really exciting area of research. And so this is the kinds of diagrams I was going to show you with the mass-independent fractionation and the mass-dependent fractionation. Fish look like one thing and oars look like another, and you can figure all kinds of cool things out. So I'm going to skip this. And I'm just going to skip them all and just leave you with some conclusions from these studies. And we did this study with the Michigan Dental Association because dentists, as it turns out, are really interested in what happens, you know, the health effects of mercury because, first of all, they work with mercury every day with fillings, but also they need fine motor skills, which is something that mercury poisoning can take away. And they also, for whatever reason, they eat a lot of fish, and that was really handy for us. So what we learned is that total mercury in hair is a good biomarker for exposure to methylmercury coming just from fish. And that's because the methylmercury is the only form that can go through the blood-brain barrier and make it to your hair. Total mercury in urine, though, although epidemiologists for years have been using that as a measure for exposure to inorganic mercury, it turns out that it's not a very good marker of that. It turns out that the body converts some of the methylmercury to inorganic mercury, and we find that in the urine. And so we had to revise our thinking about what the meaning of high levels in urine are. They can be either from inorganic or organic. And so among fish eaters, total mercury overestimates the exposure from dental amalgams. And I'm not going to go into the details. But what I want to do is just leave you with, I feel like I'm a detective and I'm looking for clues in the isotopes, and we look at lead and we look at mercury, but we also have other tools that we use, strontium and copper and zinc. And it's a really exciting, expanding area of science that I've been fortunate to be able to be a part of. And thank you for your attention.